Hey everybody, it's Ham Radio Now, episode 114. These TAPR conference episodes really build up the episode count. I'm Gary Pierski and 4AQ. Who are we going to be hearing from today? Let's see, it's... John Hansen, W2FS. John's very entertaining speaker, and he is going to be talking about Raspberry Pi applications in digital communications, a mobile Xastir-based APRS station. And I know how to pronounce Xastir only because he pronounced it in the program, and he just learned that day. Xastir is an APRS client program. I think everybody knows what a Raspberry Pi is, that tiny little micro computer. So that's what he's going to be talking about, and we'll get to that talk in just a moment. But first, I got to get used to doing commercials, sort of. Now, I was a commercial disc jockey for some time in my checkered career. I should be used to the idea of doing commercials now and then, but here on Ham Radio Now, it's still kind of a unique thing for me. But it's important because some people paid a lot of money for me to get out to Seattle to record these things. The first group was you, ham radio operators, who about 115 of you contributed to a Kickstarter that made it possible for me to get out there and record and then come back here and do all the editing and producing and put things online. So thanks to you, you came up with about $6,000, a little more than half of our goal. And then we've also got our commercial underwriters, the folks that put in some big money. The first one I'm going to talk about briefly is Elecraft, and the two radios that they've got that they're promoting the most are the K3 and KX3. K3's desktop, although it's a kind of a small desktop, HF and 6 meter transceiver, and it'll go up to 2 meters with an optional transverter. The KX3 is they're calling it an ultra portable HF through 6 meters and 2 meters with an optional module. So those are the two that they're pushing the hardest. But if you look down on their website, there's a whole lot of other stuff that they've got. 500 watt solid state amp, automatic band switching, no tune type amp, an auto tuner with a smart antenna switch. This is kind of cute. The one of those is a K3, and one of them is just a internet remote control with no radio guts in it. So it's just like operating a K3, except it's located someplace else. High-performance pan adapter, a bunch of other cute things. K2 is still around, and this is the one that I find the cutest. I saw somebody showing this off at a... it was actually not a ham fest. It was a maker fair. They were demonstrating this at a maker fair. It caught a lot of attention. Cute little KX1 CW transceiver. So you want to stop by Elecraft.com and see what they've got. Second is Flex Radio Systems. And Flex Radio is, of course, promoting their new 6000 series, the 6500 and 6700, totally software-defined radios. And the big deal with them is that they are taking RF from the antenna connector, and I think they go through maybe just a little bit of filtering, but not much, and then right into the A to D converter. And then everything else is digital, and that opens up the possibility of doing a lot of really neat stuff and making a very high-performance radio. And they do still have the 3000 and 1500 series of radios, and those are software-defined radios, too. The 6000 series is more advanced. In fact, let me promote the next talk that's going to be coming out of the TAPR DCC here on Ham Radio Now. Stephen Hicks, N5AC, is going to be doing a 6000 series update, and he'll go through the differences between steps that Flex has been through in developing software-defined radios as they arrived at the 6000 series and why they did the things they did and made the decisions that they did. So that should be pretty interesting coming up. So stop by flexradio.com, check out the 6000 series, the 1500, the 3000, everything they've got in the Flex Radio line. And our final commercial underwriter is TAPR itself, and they get the long description in this episode. So let me tell you a little bit about TAPR. TAPR is dedicated to advancing the amateur radio art. They're focused on digital communications in all its forms. And if you're interested in anything digital in amateur radio, you will find like-minded hams to both support and challenge you in TAPR. There are special interest groups and a bunch of specialty mailing lists to keep you in touch with hams who share your niche. You'll also find kits to help you get started building stuff. You can start with simple projects and work your way up to a full high-performance software-defined transceiver. But you need to know that many of the kits are done as limited production runs just to get projects off the ground. Then TAPR members and their designers move on to the next project. So if something piques your interest, don't wait too long. TAPR sponsors the DCC, of course, along with the ARRL, and they host forums at some of the larger hamfests throughout the year. You can expect a big presence at Dayton with a booth, a forum, and a dinner. They publish their quarterly newsletter, the Packet Status Register. And I love that they've kept the name Packet in that. Yes, Packet is still around, and TAPR keeps their hand in it. But like TAPR itself, the Packet Status Register is now all things digital in amateur radio. Membership in TAPR is $25 a year. That'll get you a discount on some of the kits. And of course, I'm going to point you to their website, TAPR.org for more. And now it's time to head back over to Seattle and find out what John Hansen did to get APRS running in his mobile.
How's that? Okay. So I'd like to introduce to everybody John Hansen, W2FS. And he's running on fumes. He got in late last night. So it should be a very entertaining talk on Raspberry Pi applications and digital communications, a mobile X-Store-based APRS station. Take it away, John.
You know, if you wanted to go from Minneapolis to Chicago yesterday, you might go down to the airport about 10 o'clock in the morning, well, maybe 8 o'clock in the morning, catch your 10 o'clock flight. The 10 o'clock flight from Minneapolis to Chicago left at 9:15 in the evening. And interestingly enough, it flew over Arkansas on the way to Chicago. That's the situation in Chicago yesterday, and I got in 7.5 hours late, which is a new record. Last year, I only got in 4 hours late. So I am beginning to wonder. Let me talk a little bit about this presentation and how it's organized before we actually get into it. There is a paper in the proceedings. The purpose of the paper in the proceedings was to document a step-by-step process for putting together the project that I'm going to describe in the talk today. If I actually went through that step-by-step process today, I think it would bore you out of your mind. Think of it as a Heathkit manual. Just go through it and move from step to step, and if you do that, you'll end up with the same result that I've got. My talk today is going to talk about component selection and what the purpose of the project was and how we ended up doing it, or how I ended up doing it, and what it cost. So it's complementary to what's in the proceedings, but it's not duplicative of it. Secondly, you should know that I'm not an expert on any of this, which I figure is probably a typical ham radio approach to things. If you don't know enough to do it, well, go ahead and do it anyway. And you probably learn something along the way. But the computer we're going to be talking about runs Linux. I'm not a Linux expert by any stretch of the imagination. And the program that we're going to be using here is Xastir. By the way, I don't know about you, but I grew up learning how to pronounce things by reading them and guessing how it was pronounced. When I was 12 years old, there were electronics parts stores in every major or minor city in America. And I'm not talking about Radio Shack. There were real electronics parts stores. And what I used to do when I was 12 was to take my copy of Electronics Illustrated and make a list of the parts that I was going to need in order to build the project that was in Electronics Illustrated. And then I would go down to the radio parts store, and all there was a counter. And then there were racks behind the counter, and you'd walk up to the guy at the counter, and you'd tell him what you needed, and he would go back and take the parts off the racks. So I'm, 11, 12 years old. I take the bus downtown. walk into the store. And I think the first thing I asked for was a 10K audio tape or patio meter. Now, here's the thing. The guy went back and picked up a potentiometer off the racks and put it down in front of me and said, there you are. And waited to start laughing till I'd left the store. And I think that's a real act of kindness. I had always thought this was called Xastir until this morning when I met the guy that's responsible for it. So I believe I got it right now as Xastir, but who knows. Anyway, just for those two or three people that maybe don't own one of these, I'm surprised I can't go down to the local Safeway and find these at the checkout stand. This is an impulse item if there ever was one. I first got my hands on one of these at the DCC last year where the folks from Northwest Digital were kind enough to bring one, and I hadn't been able to get my hands on one, and it was really kind of neat to look at. Now they're available pretty much everywhere. This is a computer that's basically the size of a credit card. It does run Linux. It has, oh, come on. Well, that's not gonna work. Cheap pointers. It has a Ethernet jack. It has two USB ports. Now this comes in two flavors. There is the A flavor and the B flavor. This is the top of the line, $35 unit. And it has the network port and two USB ports. It has 512 megs of memory built into the Broadcom processor that runs the whole thing. Because there's some tradition of naming computers after fruit. Apricot. Apple, well, you know. And the Pi comes from the fact that they envisioned these children learning to program this using the Python language, hence Pi. So that's why it's called a Raspberry Pi. So they envisioned this as a really, really, really low-cost solution, so they didn't want these children to have to buy monitors. So among other things, there is RCA video out, so that you can put the display from like an old television set on here and you don't actually have to buy a monitor. But when you get more interested in this, there's also an HDMI output which gives you a lot better screen resolution. They didn't want the kids to have to go buy power supplies, and they figured these days with all of us getting a new cell phone every 2 years, everybody's got a box of cell phone chargers at home. And all you gotta do is take one of those old cell phone charger and plug it into the micro USB jack here, and it powers right up. Now, the requirement here is 1 amp, and if you look at most of these chargers, they do supply 1 amp, and in fact, if you're getting the ones that are capable of charging iPads, they're like 2-point-something amps. So there are a lot of these lying around, so you gotta figure that's, you know, basically free. And there's no hard drive, of course, at this price. Instead, there's an SD card slot, which is on the bottom of the board. And so you go get yourself, you need at least a 4 gig card. 4 gig cards are $5, 8 gig cards are $10. You know, spring for the extra money. And you're ready to go, literally ready to go. Now, you're going to have to install some version of Linux. The usual way people do this is with a version of Debian called Wheezy. You download it off the web and you burn it onto this SD card. All the directions are in the paper in the proceedings. And then you're up and running, not just with command line Linux, but with a graphical user interface. So I'm sure an awful lot of us got to think, well, I don't know, if you're like me, you bought one of these without having any idea what you were gonna do with it. As I said, it's really an impulse item. And so the next question you gotta ask is, what is this thing good for? You know, what am I going to do with it? And the applications that ham radio operators have come up with are just amazing. It'll work as a standalone iGate. It'll work both as a WinGate, a WinLink server, and a WinLink client. You can hook this up to a GMSK board and make a D-Star hotspot for yourself. Of course, you could do keyboard-to-keyboard packet. It has an audio connector on. I didn't point at that, but there's audio in and audio out on the thing. And so you can use this for HF digital. I'm going to focus on APRS here today. And perhaps the most unique usage that I've heard about it is people are actually using this as a radio transmitter. Not something that connects to a radio transmitter, but an actual radio transmitter. It's been put on Whisper, FM, and single sideband. Now, I've not actually done hardly any of these things, but if you go onto the web and you search for this stuff, you can find the documentation for the people that are that have been doing this. So, I was thinking, I really like that Kenwood D710 hooked up to an AVMap. It really looks good. And I can imagine being in my car and having a Kenwood D710 and having an AVMap sitting on the dashboard, being able to see where all the other APRS stations were. And the only reason, well, there's a couple reasons I don't have that, but one of them has to do with four figures in the price. It's just not going to be cheap. So how cheaply could you do something like that? And that's where I'm going with this project. So here were my design criteria for doing that kind of thing mobile. Obviously, it's got to run on 13 volts in the automobile. I want a visual map presentation of all of the stations in the area. I want to see where they are on a map, just like I can with an AV map. Now, since we're going to be running an APRS application, let's also get ourselves a wireless keyboard and be able to do APRS messaging from this thing as well. One key design criteria here was I don't want to have to download those maps from the internet, because while some people have the internet in their car, most of the people that are interested in doing this are interested in doing it from the standpoint of emergency communication, and you may not have a cellular data link. And so you can't really figure on getting your maps that way. So I've got to be able to put the maps on the Raspberry Pi. Again, this process is described in great detail in the paper. And of course, I'm a ham radio operator. This has got to be cheap. So that was the idea. Here's the hardware. Well, of course, you need a Raspberry Pi. You're going to need a power supply for the Raspberry Pi, and now we're not using your cell phone charger anymore because the cell phone charger wants to plug into an AC jack, and I want to put this in a car. I'm going to talk about a range of different monitors in a range of different price categories that you might consider using. I need a keyboard and a mouse, or perhaps a keyboard and a trackpad, and I really want this to be wireless because I don't want to have these cables running all over my car. I just want to put the keyboard on my lap and type. It's packet. We're going to need a TNC unless you're planning to do the sort of sound card packet thing. I'll talk about where this came from in a little bit. And, of course, you'll need a 2-meter transmitter and perhaps a GPS receiver if you want your position to be beaconed out from your mobile as well. So those are the hardware items that are involved. Let's start with power adapter. I like this one. This one is about $12, I think. You'll notice it's got two USB jacks in it, so you can take that cable off your cell phone charger and plug it directly in here, get the 5 volts, and run that into your Raspberry Pi. But it also has two accessory plugs, so to give you 12 volts. And you'll see that for the monitor that I'm planning to use with this, or the range of monitors that I'm going to use with this, one of these would come in very, very handy. All right, let's talk about monitor options. I am not responsible for creating the documentation that went with the advertisements for these monitors. This one, I believe, let's see if... Okay, never mind. I thought there was a link here. This one is sold by Adafruit, a company out of New York that sells a lot of these maker kinds of stuff. It is a pretty high resolution HDMI capable monitor that will run off of 12 volts and has been tested down to 9 volts. And it worked on that as well. It is $159. This thing, let me get this off of here. These are both 7-inch monitors. This thing is gorgeous. I don't mean her. Honestly, I didn't even think I was saying that. The monitor is gorgeous. Am I that twisted? I can't believe it. Yes, I love the look of this monitor. It's capable of 1080p. I mean, it's high res, really good looking monitor, but it's $229. Now, I rolled out both of these because I'm cheap. I'm a ham radio operator. But if you're setting up a mobile MCOM station, particularly if you're doing it with public money, you might just specify this is something that you really, really needed in each of these vehicles. But here are a couple of other more modest choices. This one is an old 12-inch monitor that I had on a computer years and years ago and just happens to run on 12 volts. And I went out and looked, and there's still a lot of 12-volt monitors out there. Most people are using to, like, play movies in their travel trailers or whatever, but you can get relatively inexpensive. I paid quite a bit of money for this, but it was like 15 years ago. But you can get really relatively inexpensive monitors. This one is a 7-inch backup camera monitor from a car. It's $35. Actually, I think it's $32. I'm not sure. But it's right in that range. Both of these monitors are on display in the demonstration room, so you can take a look to see what they look like. You cannot simply plug this monitor, this cheap monitor, in and get an image that looks that good. You're going to have to play with Linux a bit to get it to display really that well on a small monitor. And of course, all that information on how to do that is contained in the conference paper. But, you know, now we're getting down to a range that I would describe as being cheap. It's a 7-inch monitor. It's designed to be mounted in cars because it was originally intended as something you get a backup camera and display. A wireless keyboard trackpad. You'll see the model. This is a Logitech one. It was $30. The thing I love about this one is I now have the mouse track or trackpad and the keyboard on the same device, and it only requires one USB dongle to run. You've only got two USB ports on the Pi, and you might want to save one of them for a GPS receiver. Now, the alternative, of course, is to put a powered USB hub and hook it up to the Pi, and many, many people do that because they want to put more USB stuff on. But in a car, maybe you don't want all those boxes sitting around. Maybe you just want the box with the Pi. And so keeping it down to one USB dongle was really, really nice. Now, when I started looking for these, everybody said this is a great keyboard, and it actually, it's quite small, has a nice feel. You can see this in the demonstration room. But I got reports from a lot of people that it didn't work with Raspberry Pi. And then I got reports from a lot of other people that it worked great with Raspberry Pi. And fortunately, I ran into both situations, so I have some sense about why those two reports are so disparate. When I hooked up my Raspberry Pi through the RCA video jack into my backup camera monitor, this works great. When I hooked it up, again, using the same USB port, but pulled out the VGA or the RCA plug and plugged in the HDMI monitor, it stopped working. I don't know why, but I think that explains why there were some reports one way and some reports the other. But you know, there's lots of wireless keyboards and trackpads around. I'm using a different wireless keyboard in the setup in the demonstration room for the 12-inch monitor, and it's yet another wireless keyboard that was also, I think it was $12. But I'm using a hardware mouse. And it's working great with the HDMI. I think it's really a matter of experimenting and asking around about what works and what doesn't work. Which brings us to the TNC. When I introduced TNCX, it's been over 10 years ago, I made it open source. It was the first project I'd ever done that was open source, and a lot of people have been urging me to do this, and they said, look, people will find bugs in your code and you can fix it. And people will have ideas for expanding this code and you'll have a better product. 12 years went by and I never heard from anybody. Till last summer when I was approached by John Wiseman. You may recognize the call sign, G8BPQ, especially if you were involved in the early packet days back in the late 80s and early 90s. If you were running a bulletin board back then, you were probably running the BPQ software. This is the man that created it. And he said, well, I took your source code, and first I converted it to assembly language. And then I made some modifications to it so that it would be specifically designed for a Raspberry Pi. And the modifications are very interesting. It supports both a serial link and an I2C connection. Now, the key difference between that is serial data communication is basically point to point, but I2C is a bus. So the idea is you can hang more than one TNC on the same Raspberry Pi, and you can stack them up. And when I created the board, I took the general I/O connector and we translated that up to this board so I can stack another one on top of this. And so, but you have to use I2C rather than serial in order to do that. So you might be thinking to yourself, well, wait a minute, how much software is there on packet radio that supports I2C? Xastir certainly doesn't. And so John also wrote a utility that takes the I2C port and presents it as a COM port to the software that you have running on the Raspberry Pi. So now you can do this with any software. So you could, for example, in your mobile communications setup, figure, well, APRS is on one frequency and WinLink is on another frequency, so what I want to do is stack two of these things, give each of them their own pseudo serial port, and have one of them be my WinLink mailbox and the other be APRS and have them both running at the same time. And you can do it. It looks like this. Now, the neat thing, the Raspberry Pi is on the bottom, the TNCX is on the top, and the really neat thing about this is a Bud Pi sandwich box. I first ran across this about a month ago. The idea is that it will hold, I'm not going to put this all the way together, thank you.
Hand away from my.
I'm sorry. The idea is that it will hold the Raspberry Pi and one add-on board that's the same size, and there's little clips on these two pieces are identical. There's little clips on each side, so on one side it holds the Pi, and on the other side it holds whatever board you're stacking on top of the Pi. And then there are these breaks in the box that allow you to hook up all the connections to it. So people have been asking me whether there was a box that worked with this. Yes, there is. This from Mouser Electronics sells for, I believe, $6.40. Okay, so TNC Pi is a specialized version of TNCX that's designed to plug directly into a Raspberry Pi. No more connections needed. All you've got here is the radio connector, and this is a DB9 that's compatible with Cantronics, so you can even buy the cable if you choose to do that. And it costs, it's available as a kit. It's powered off the Pi too, by the way, so there's no other wire to be running there. And it costs $40 as a kit. John Wiseman had to talk to me three times before he convinced me to make this. He emailed me the first time, explained what the project was, asked if I was, he doesn't want to be a manufacturer. He asked if I wanted to offer the kit for sale. And I said, who's going to want one of these? 3 months later, he said, I'm finished with the software now. Are you interested? And I'm still thinking to myself, well, I do already have most of the parts, because I produce TNCX, but who's going to want one of these? So 2 months later, he contacted me again and said, look, if you don't want to make this, I'm going to go find somebody else. And I thought, well, I do have most of the parts. And he said, and I've been on the listservs, and I'm pretty sure we could sell 40 of them. I said, okay. So I bought a small batch of boards, and I put it up just on that listserv. It's Raspberry Pi 4 ham radio on groups.yahoo.com. I sold out in 40 minutes. I have never had a product takeoff like this. The reason I'm not getting much work done, fortunately, I'm on sabbatical this year, but the reason I'm not getting much work done is I'm spending most of my time putting parts in bags and putting them in boxes and putting them into the mail. I've never seen anything like this. Last week, I ordered another 1,000 PC boards. I'm worried. It's been fun, but I've just never seen anything quite like it. So that's the TNC. You might want a GPS. There's lots to choose from. Here's one that uses a Surf 3 chip, has a USB interface. It's $31. I'm pretty sure that people have, this is one of those that people have told me will work with this project, but there are lots of others. So let's take a look now at the budget. Raspberry Pi is $35. You're going to need an SD card. A 4 gig would do it. An 8 gig is cheap. A 16 gig I have on one of mine. The more space you got, the more maps you can load up there. It's not possible to load all of the USA maps at once. You're going to have to pick the areas you're interested in. But it's relatively simple to go to the web and get the maps you need and load them up. Pi kit is $40. I don't offer that wired and tested yet because I can't keep up with the kits. Monitor was not 35, it was 32. The keyboard trackpad was 30. The USB adapter for the car is 13. Here's the box. And here's a GPS if you wanted it. And I haven't got a radio yet. However, on this list. However, over in the demonstration room, I've got this hooked up to a Baofeng UV5R that I got for $40, dual bander 5 watts from China. So, I mean, we could keep this down, but it's under $200. And so I thought that was pretty good. Let me see if we can access the web here. No. Okay. Yeah, I've got a notice up that I'm not shipping right now. But here you go. You can have your Raspberry Pi a la mode with a TNCX on top. There's the Xastir setup. And Here are some early prototypes of two of these stacked up. You could tell they're early versions because now, of course, the Raspberry Pi or TNC Pi board is red, as it should be. And the manual's available here. Actually, there's quite a bit more information about setting this kind of thing up in the conference paper than there is in the manual. Now, we have about 10, 15 minutes left, and I want to raise another topic, and then I promise I'll... Well, let me take some questions first, and then I want to talk about something else.
How many have you stacked up to try it?
I don't know anybody personally that's done more than two. In theory, I think there's 63 addresses available, but the Raspberry Pi is going to choke long before that. Really, it would depend on how much each was being used. I mean, the fact that they all exist, you'd have two problems. One is eventually you'd run out of power. These things draw about 25 mAh, I think, which is easily handled by the Pi. And the other thing you would run into is ultimately data throughput. Yeah.
My question is, the board, is it open hardware, the design of the board itself?
That's an interesting question. The current version of this firmware I didn't write. I wrote a lot of it, but John Wiseman wrote the assembly code, made the changes to it, so he owns it. And I think he's willing to make that code available, but I haven't talked to him. I mean, I've been so busy shipping these things that I haven't talked to him about it. When I did it as open source for TNCX, I did it under the modified BSD license, not the GPL. So you could derive products from it and not have to make the derived products open source. So I'm really not sure what's going on with that. I don't think you'd have any trouble getting that. The board, I'm just not as keen on doing that as I am on the code. You could lay out a board. I mean, the schematic diagram's available. It's not a big deal to do a board layout. I don't really want somebody producing something that looks exactly like it and then people asking me for support for it. That's the one thing. Yeah, you may have noticed that MFJ is making a TNCX. Now, they're doing that with my permission, and they're paying me a small royalty for it. But the deal was they did the customer support on theirs, and I'll do the customer support on mine. And in reality, that deal has worked out pretty well for them and not so well for me. Because I just can't seem to turn people down when they have problems with their MFJ products. Anybody else?
You were very kind to offer to put my kit together if I asked you to. Because I'm, as I mentioned, I don't have depth of field vision. One thing that I found challenging was the header block.
Mm-hmm.
Have you considered doing a breakout cardboard template or something to help get that spacing right?
I don't understand. I understand the problem of getting the soldering iron in between the pins and putting the solder there.
But you often end up with a little wobble.
Really? Even after you put the spacer in?
Well, I didn't have a spacer. At least I couldn't see it.
Okay. These kits ship with a spacer here and two screws that hold this firmly together.
Okay.
And it's not going anywhere. And if you want to stack more than one of these for another 50 cents, I'll sell you a spacer that is a male to female spacer, so you can screw another one on top of that and stack them up with these bars in
okay,
here.
I must have just missed it, but I did get it together and it does work.
Good. For some reason, when you asked me that, I didn't recognize who it was or I would have built it for you. I'm sorry. I mean, you're doing a lot of good work for us, and it's the least we can do. Anybody else? Okay, I came here in part to ask for some help. People have been asking me for at least 10 years to produce a 9600 baud version of the TNCX.
Yes. Yes.
Now wait. And I have resisted that for 10 years in part because of the customer service load. That is to say, they're a lot more finicky than 1,200 baud TNCs, and I'm worried that somebody is going to buy one of these kits, run it into the microphone jack, and then blame me because the TNC doesn't work. Or they'll have the output of it so maladjusted that the deviation won't be appropriate and it won't work very well. Or they'll hook it up to a radio that doesn't really even support that. And so people will be saying, it's my TNC that's at fault. And that's what I've been saying now for some years. However, with this product, it is possible, using the software that John Wiseman has written, to make a multi-port router hooked up to multiple radios, and it could be done at different speeds if we had different speed TNCs. This has caused me to revisit this a little bit. And I've talked to John about it a bit. And so I've gone back and I read James Miller's paper again that I read years ago, the Shape of Bits to Come, where he was talking about how this was done. And I've gone back to some of the other stuff, and I've looked at the circuits that were used for that sort of stuff back in the 1980s, which just seemed to involve a barrel full of parts. And I'm talking about the actual modem part of this. And what I've done with the TNCX is I took an off-the-shelf Bell 202 modem chip, I put an audio filter on it to improve its performance substantially, and that's why TNCX works better than a Cantronics KPC3, by the way. I'd like to be able to do something similar on 9600 rather than have to get into either the kinds of designs that were done in the 80s or the other suggestion that I'm sure most people would have, which is, why don't you do it in DSP? And, you know, I don't have a highly trained mathematician on staff the way John does, and I'm getting really too old to learn a lot of new math. But it sure would be nice if I could pull a chip off the shelf that would do that. Now, there is, from the same company that makes my modem chip, a CML589 chip that's designed for GMSK, not the raised cosine stuff that James Miller was doing. And I take a look at the waveform out of that chip, and I take a look at the diagrams in James Miller's paper, and the raised cosine looks awfully close to Gaussian to me, and I'm kind of wondering if they'd interoperate. And if anybody has any thoughts on either that or any other way to do this with a relatively low part count, I would, and by the way, another problem that I would have using something like a DSPIC is there's a guy that had made an add-on board for the TNCX that used that, and we had to bolt in a new regulator and bolt it to the box in order to dissipate the heat from it. So I'm kind of looking to keep the processor fairly simple. Anybody have any thoughts on that? I'd appreciate if you'd talk to me this weekend. Yes.
To your succinct question of the CML589, I believe that's what's in a Cantronics 9612.
Really?
And the guy to talk to is Dennis tomorrow when he's here.
Dennis who?
Dennis Rosenauer.
Okay.
He's the math guy.
He'll be tomorrow.
He'll be here tomorrow. And,
all right.
And he has a 9612 on his bench because we benchmark against it.
Well, that would be really useful. I've got a bunch of those samples, and of course they're easily available, and that would really help a lot. What BT do you use? Do you know? With that chip, you have to specify a BT, a 0.3 or 0.5, I think.
0.5 is MSK.
Okay.
So we've done a lot of things with alphabet soup. So FSK became MSK if BT is 5, and then we filtered it and called it GMSK, and then we changed BT to 0.3, which no longer makes it MSK, but we forgot to mention that.
You know, I asked John Wiseman about this because he was thinking about doing a 9600 baud version of this, and obviously when he says he's interested in doing something, he gets it done. And he said, I think this is fascinating. He said, oh, what difference does it make? just do a GMSK. Don't worry about whether it interoperates with the other stuff. And I thought about all the people owning Kenwood D700s and D710s and putting out a standard there on 0.39 that was complete, or some other frequency that was completely incompatible with them. And I thought, wait a minute, I don't really want to do that. If, I mean, it'd be much better if this stuff worked with all the other equipment that's out there in the field rather than forging a new path. But I appreciate it.
One more question.
How many will buy it?
I did bring almost, I brought a little over 40 of them, which means that if everybody wants one, you can't have it. Hey, by the way, one thing about that, I realized every time I walk in, I walked into Dayton and people just kept throwing money at me. And hold on. Look, if you're, I know there's some people here from outside the country, and the shipping rates to outside the country have just gotten ridiculous. I used to be able to ship product to Europe for like $7, and now it's like $13. I mean, they doubled last Christmas is what happened, and these people have really been hit hard. So if there's anybody who wants to buy one and not have to worry about shipping it out of the country, why don't you come first, and I'll make sure you're taken care of. And if I do run out, I will take orders and not charge you shipping when I get to shipping them probably next week. So anyway, thank you very much.
And then, John, you're set up in the demo room, right?
I'm in the demo
room. Okay, so you can get more of John in the demo room.
Hey, Bill.